Okay, we'll run these quizzes. So here is the first question. A function that calls itself is an example of what kind of function? The four choices: recursive, iterative, non-terminating, and mirror. Should be able to write down this answer in 5 seconds. The next recap quiz. Which of the following are false about recursive functions? The four choices given, any one or more may be false. So please read them carefully. Choice A is must have at least one parameter. Choice B can have only call by value parameters. Choice C may not terminate for some input parameters. And choice D cannot call any function other than itself. So whatever is true about a recursive function, you leave that aside. Whatever is false, this is the third one. For any recursion to terminate, the values of parameters A can change in any order, B must move monotonically towards a termination case, C must stay unchanged in all calls to the function, and D must never become negative. So which one of these is the right answer for the values of parameters to be modified such that the recursion terminates? Virahanka numbers, which were mentioned in one of the lectures, can be computed. Now these are four choices: can be computed recursively but not iteratively, can be computed iteratively but not recursively, can be computed both recursively as well as iteratively, and neither iteratively nor recursive. Again, a straightforward question. Next question. When a function recursively calls itself, which of the following happens? A, the activation record on top of the call stack is popped out. B, a new activation record is pushed in the call stack. C, the activation record on top of the call stack is overwritten. Or D, no activation records are pushed or popped. These are the four choices. So when a function recursively calls itself, what happens? Again, a fairly straightforward question. Alright, we move to the next question. Specifying a termination case, A guarantees that a recursive function terminates for all inputs, B may not cause a recursive function to terminate for all inputs, C terminates a function if it calls itself, and D helps the compiler avoid generating code for recursive function. So let's spend 2 or 3 minutes quickly discussing these questions. Question 1. A function that calls itself is an example of what? Recursive. So the answer is A. Which of the following are false about recursive functions? A, must have at least one parameter. Not necessary. How will recursion work? It can read a variable and then call itself recursively and return a value. B, can have only call by value parameters. It can also have call by reference parameters. C, may not terminate for some input parameters. Possible if it is not well formed. D, cannot call any function other than itself. So you say only C is true, C is false, or what are all false? B and D. A and D. Okay. I would like during the discussion session for people having these different answers to discuss it and figure out what it is. For recursion to terminate, which of the following options is correct? Must have monotonically decreasing or moving towards a termination case. Is that clear? Why it must be so? Otherwise, the recursion will not terminate. What is the question, answer to this question? See, you can of course compute this both iteratively and recursively. In fact, we'll look at some of these aspects through an example later. When a function recursively calls itself, what happens? A new activation record is pushed in the call stack. When a function is called from any program, even if it is not recursive, wouldn't there be an activation record that gets pushed? So in short, this is the process of invoking a function, whether you are invoking it from within a function recursively or whether you are invoking a function only once, an activation record has to go on to the stack. What is the answer to this question? May not cause a recursive function to terminate for all inputs. Depends upon how carefully you have chosen the input value and how carefully you are writing your function. So we have seen that calling a function from itself has same mechanisms of function calls and returns which we are studying. That means an activation record gets created when a function is called. Whenever a function returns, that particular activation record from the stack is popped out and the values are appropriately returned, values are transmitted and so on. So there is nothing new in the mechanism, except that when a function recursively calls itself, upon successive returns, the then existing values of the internal variables are used for the subsequent processing after the recursive call. It's an elegant and natural way of solving many problems, while iteration is contrived. I will mention that in a short while. What about mutually recursive functions? Function 1 calls function 2, which calls function 3, and which calls function 1. It's perfectly possible, but that's a mutual recursion where recursion is not so very obvious. What is important is that the same mechanism of function calls and returns, which works perfectly for this. So what does it do? It actually takes the integer question Q1 marks, integer Q2 marks. This is the statement which invokes that function from the main program, cipher equal to new n Q1 marks comma Q2 marks. So this new encoding function, this is the function. It has two integer parameters. Now look at the switch. Switch is on Q2 marks. In one case, when Q1 marks are equal to 1, it returns 6, else it returns 2 into a recursive call Q1 marks minus 1. So what does it do? Q1 marks are successively reduced. Okay, for whatever value of Q2 marks that you have given, in case it is 1, it will do this, else it will return this value. There is a break after this. What does the default case mean? Anyway, we have discussed this in the quiz. So what does it do basically? Let us just discuss this particular part. So what will happen if Q1 marks is not equal to 1? For example, let's say it is 3. It will take these marks 3. It will multiply 2 by these into a function call Q1 marks minus 1, that is 2. Since 2 is still not 1, it will come back again and do it. Multiply 2 into this of 1. And then last time when it will come, it will find it is 1. It will return 6. Will the final value return be 6? No. Because this value will be returned to the previous call. And that will be used to calculate something new which will be returned to the previous to previous call. And finally, when you come back through all these jamela, you should get the right answers. So here are some caveats or rules. Number one, you must specify how to terminate the recursion. Otherwise, it can go on forever. And it is as hard to spot an endless recursion as it is to spot an endless iteration. Both require application of mind while you construct the program. This is more important for the recursive function. You must ensure that in any invocation, the recursion changes parameters in an orderly fashion. And how? That the recursion eventually terminates. So that is the responsibility of the person who writes that function. So look at this. encode m into n. It encodes m comma n minus 1 into 3 if both of them are greater than 1. Encodes m minus 1 by 1 into 2 if m is greater than 1 but n is 1. And it returns 2 into 3 equal to 6 if m is equal to 1, n is equal to 1. This is the termination case. But this is the termination case for the innermost invocation of the recursive function. The innermost invocation by which time these values are reduced to 1 and 1. And when you go, you have to compile all other computations that would be done with this, further returning some values, etc. Notice that the parameters are changed in an orderly way to ensure termination. So when you start with encode m comma n, you actually invoke encode m into n minus 1 if m and n are greater than 1. Only when this n reduces to 1, that is, you have a larger value of m but n is equal to 1, then it suddenly calls encode m minus 1 comma 1 into 2, again for successive values of this. So each one ensures that the target of the parameters are moving towards a value where you will have the termination case reached where m and n are 1. So think of all possible valuations of parameters as ordered with a fixed end, and recursion must change values of parameters so that we move along this order monotonically towards the fixed end. Of course, there would be situations where this monotonic movement could take one of several alternative ways. For example, if you take this to be the grid, it shows plot of m and n for different values of m and n varying from 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 here for m and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 here for n. What is the target destination of termination of the function when both of them are 1? So this is the termination case. Where you can start? You can start from any point on this grid depending upon the initial value of m and n. So this is where you have given encode 4 comma 3, for example. M is 4, n is 3. How do you think your recursive function should move? Will it move like this? The way it is coded, the way it is programmed, will the program move the values of m and n like this, changing both values simultaneously? No. The first movement is downwards, where the value of n is reduced from 3 to 2 to 1. Once n becomes 1, then the value of m is successively reduced such that m becomes 1. This is how the way the program is written. Is it not possible to do it the other way around? That first the value of m changes and then the value of n changes? Depends upon the sequence in which you have written the code or the program, the statements in your program. The point is, you cannot have a situation where this value threatens to go this side. Because if it does, then there is no termination. So this is the care that you are required to take when you solve these problems. There is also an issue on recursion versus iteration. You have done iterative solutions, they are fairly straightforward, they appear, but many times you require a whole lot of thinking to convert a particular algorithm which is actually seen to be an recursive algorithm by the very nature of its specification, and you are converting it into an iterative solution. The difference between the two is as follows. If the underlying algorithm, underlying formulation is recursive, then a recursive formulation of your program is more intuitive, is natural and succinct, very precise. But you need to worry about the termination of the recursion. And of course, you need to worry about the number of recursive calls. I'll explain it through an example why these could become excessive and therefore may cause a lot more computations to be done instead of what could be legitimately achieved with fewer computations. Iterative formulations, on the other hand, may be sometimes not very clean, not solution. And you need to worry about the loop invariants now. Just as you have to worry about recursion and recursive functions, You have to worry about iterations terminate. So you have to define the loop invariants and the termination criteria. And these could be very efficient if done properly. The efficiency point we'll discuss in a moment. The best practice is to use a judicious mix of iteration and recursion. Before we go to the next problem, I wanted to tell you about a problem which actually is a simple problem. You have written solutions for that problem as a part of writing down iterative programs. But the problem itself is fundamentally stated in terms of a recurrence relation. So let us look at that problem. This is a recursive formula. What does it represent? It's factorial of n. All of you have calculated factorial many times. How do you calculate the factorial? Suppose you have int n f, which is the final result, and let us say a variable I. I will read the value of n. I am not writing all validations, etc., but we presume that n is a positive integer. So it is a positive non-zero integer, to be very precise. Because this formulation presumes that f of 0 is equal to, what is factorial 0? So this is the starting point to kick start. If I have done this, then I can simply start with f equal to 1, set up a simple counting iteration, this iteration will be executed how many times? N times. I equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. And if I simply say f is equal to f multiplied by I and come out here and I output f. Will I get the solution correctly? I will calculate factorial n, assuming of course that the input is a positive input. You are all familiar with this program, easily done. But this program implements the solution using an iterative process. If you were to do it recursively, how will you implement it? So let us say, instead of this portion, I want to have a statement which says f is equal to so I do want to calculate f. I read the value of n here. I invoke a function f is equal to fact n, and whatever I get here, I print that out. I want you to write a recursive function fact which takes n as a parameter and recursively calls itself to calculate factorial n. In short, a recursive function which implements this particular formulation, which is a recursive formula. So this is done by Rajat, just defines in factorial n, if n is equal 0, returns 1, else return n into fact n minus 1. The only problem is the star is written slightly above the line and there is no declaration of n either within the program or within the parameter. Here is another one by Pranjal. In fact, int n, if n is equal to 0, it returns 1. else it returns n into fact n minus 1. For solution, I had written it the same way, except that I try to write it more formally. This is my own personal preference. Whenever I write a for, whenever I write a while, in short, whenever I write a construct which permits more than one statement to be written, then I always write brasses. Suppose tomorrow I want to modify this program and add one more statement here, and I forget to add brasses, it could have disastrous consequence, because then this statement would not remain part of that if. Else, I return fact n minus 1. So very simple, it will recursively call itself, and when it comes down, when it reduces n to 0, it will return 1. What is the termination condition? N is 0. How are we guaranteeing that the termination will be reached? Because the recursive call to fact always reduces n by 1 wherever it is. Now let me ask you another question. You have studied Virahanka numbers. What is the recursive relationship which defines the nth Virahanka number? Is that correct? This is a recursive formulation which you can easily write using a recursive call. Just like you return n into factorial n minus 1, you Virahanka n minus 1 plus Virahanka n minus 1. Right? Now, which formulation is better and one? A recursive formulation in this case is very natural and intuitive, but look at the amount of work that the computer has to do. Consider both cases. First, consider this function. Every time I come here, the compiler will have to create an activation record and put it on the stack. When it then goes back again to do these computations, it will again do this check. If it is not, the compiler will call the recursively this function again, another activation record. So there are overheads. If n is equal to 5, the recursive call will be 5 times, and there will be 5 activation records created. As against that, if you see the iterative solution, there is a lot of work there also. The iterative solution has to do how much work? First, 5 multiplications, I into fact, successive. But more importantly, it has to 5 times increment the value of I and 5 times check whether I has become equal to greater than n. If it is greater than n, I have to quit. So 5 extra comparisons and 5 extra increments that will have to be done, other than doing 5 multiplications if n is equal to 5 and you are finding factorial 5. As against that, this will have to create activation records 5 times. Now, creating an activation record, pushing values of current variable there, then deactivating when you come out and again assigning those values, obviously takes slightly longer. So an iterative solution in this case will be slightly cheaper than a recursive call as far as the computations are concerned. Now consider this. In this case, you first call the function vn. This will recursively call agreed? Because in the same statement you are saying Vn is equal to Vn minus 1 plus Vn. So in order to do these two, you have to call Vn minus 1 and you also have to call Vn minus 1. Vn minus 1, when it is called, this in turn will call Vn minus 2, Vn minus. This on the other hand will now call what? Vn minus 2 will call what? Do you notice the extra work that you are forcing the compiler to do? Vn minus 3 was called by Vn minus 2. Vn minus 2 is independently called in another chain of events, and that in short invokes this. In fact, it is not difficult to understand that there will be a large tree of functions which will be called successively like this, and the entire tree will be repeated here, and this will happen for every such call. So the number of function calls that get generated, the number of activation records that get generated, and the activities that need to be done in terms of computations, comparisons, assignments, additions, etc., etc., are far too costly. In fact, try to run with a double or some such large int, not just an int, say long int. Try to run the factorial calculation both iteratively and recursively. Even on code blocks or any other thing, you can see the significant difference in the amount of computing time it takes. The computing time for this will be extraordinarily large. So what do we learn from this? Number one, if the computations to be performed are very tiny, like an addition in this case or a multiplication in that case, then the overheads which the recursive functions cause may not be a very good idea, particularly when the number of calls are going to expand. These are going to expand exponentially, as you can see. On the other hand, if the amount of calculations to be done is significant, then there is some elegance and some simplicity in programming using recursive functions. And then it is worthwhile to pay the overhead costs of recursive functions. So that is why the last line is very important. Best practice is a judicious mix of iteration and recursion. Choose iteration when this is appropriate, choose recursion when the other one is appropriate. But in either case, be very sure to write your programs carefully such that either iterations or recursions terminate properly. Some more practice problems which indicate the need for being careful on writing such terminal conditions. So this practice problem builds on the problem that we had discussed very briefly in the class, the game of tic-tac-toe. You remember the game of tic-tac-toe? One fellow puts a cross here, another fellow puts a tick here, and so on. And we had said that we will use zeros and ones to mark the play. And we had said that instead of such empty squares, we will put the value minus one to denote something which has not been written into yet. So this is called the configuration of our tic-tac-toe box. Somebody can put a zero here, somebody can put a one here, some first player puts a zero here, second player puts a one here, third player idiotically puts a zero here, and the second player wins. This is very clear? Fine. So this is a winning move. So what is the winning move? Any move in which you have three ones or three zeros in succession across a line, column or diagonal. So a configuration, now this is a problem, this is a programming problem. A configuration of the tic-tac-toe grid is represented by a sequence of nine integer values. These values are stored in variables x1, x2, x3, x4, x5, x6, x7, x8, x9. These values represent the following points of the grid. So this first row is represented by x1, x2, x3, second by x4, x5, x6. The third column is represented by x3, x6, x9. One diagonal is represented by x3, x5, x7, etc. Once you know the thing, then in whichever way x1, x2, x3, x5, x9, etc. are written, you know exactly which variable represents which position. So this is the configuration. What should be the possible values of x1, x2, x3, etc.? 0, 1 or minus 1. There is no sanctity of any one of these values. We are presuming that minus 1 represents an empty square, We are presuming that 0 is the symbol used by the first player and 1 is the symbol used by the second player. So this configuration that we had seen will actually translate into this. X1 will be 0, X2 will be 1, X3 will be 0 here, X4 where there is nothing is minus 1, X5 is 1 and so on. So if these are the values, the variables, then this is the photographic image that it should represent in our mind. This is the situation, the board. There are a very large number of possible combinations because there are 9 variables, and although each one of them can have only 3 values, there are a large number of possible values. But not all possible combinations are correct configuration. For example, all variables having value 0, is that a possible correct combination? It's like I am playing with no opponent there, I make my first move, then I make my second move, then I make my third move, I win, but I still make my fourth move, fifth move, etc. And I put all zeros. Now that is not a valid tic-tac-toe combination. So amongst the very large number of combinations, there are some which are valid, some which are not valid configurations. You have to write a C++ program function that takes as an input an input configuration and determines who should move next. It's a simple problem. Please note, no iteration, no recursion, nothing. Just a function. The function name is next turn. And the next turn should hopefully return which of the two possible values? We have already assumed that the first player marks 0, second player marks 1. So if next turn returns 0, it is the first player's next move. If the next turn returns 1, it is the second player's move. That's the assumption we'll make. You want this function to return a numerical value 0 or 1 depending upon what you conclude by examining values of x1, x2, x3, etc. up to x0. First you have to check whether the configuration is valid. If so, count the number of zeros and ones and determine who moves next, that you have to return. In this particular case, who is supposed to move next? 1, very quickly found out. What did you do? Counted all number of zeros, counted all number of ones. If they were equal, it was 0's turn to move. If they were unequal, 1's turn to move, provided they were unequal only by 1. Otherwise, the configuration itself is invalid. So remember what I told you? It's like one player saying 0, 0, 0 before giving chance to someone. Not permit. Or other player saying 1, 1, 1. Not permit. Of course, if you presume that the fellow who wrote the program and calling this function to get the next turn has done some sensible things there so that any extraordinarily bad configuration does not come to me to begin with. But it is still useful if they check whether the configuration is valid. So please write this function. Again repeat, this is a simple C++ programming exercise. 9 variables are given, x1, x2, x3, x4, x5, x6, x7, x8, x9, all integer variables. The values that you get in, you can assume that the values are guaranteed to be either 0 or 1 or minus 1. But you still need to check whether the configuration is valid. And if it is valid, count the number of zeros and ones and determine who moves next. The first line of the function is given here, int next turn. Except what Professor Supratik has written as dot 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 is not permitted. So you have to fill up your notebook by saying int x1, comma int x2, comma int x3, comma int x4, comma int x5, comma int x6, comma int x7, comma int x8 and comma int x9, right? And then bracket close. Then of course you have to put a brass here and start writing your program. No dot dot dot, because the morning when I showed this, some fellow wrote a code to look at x1, then look at x2, and then wrote dot dot dots. Now, C++ compiler does not understand dot dot dot. So it has to be a properly written function. So is the function defined as int next turn? He is defining I and j. As you can guess, he is putting the count of all zeros in variable I and all ones in variable j. Starts with the count as zeros and he meticulously examines each variable. If x1 is 0, I is incremented, else if x1 is 1, then j is incremented. For any other value, neither of the counts is incremented. He evaluates these for each of the 9 variables x1, x2, x3, x4, x5, x6, x7, x8, x9. Now he examines the total number of zeros and total number of ones. If the total number of zeros are equal to total number of ones, then the next turn is that of the first player, that is 0, so he returns 0. If on the other hand I minus j is equal to 1, which means the number of zeros is more than number of ones, then that is the turn of 1, so he returns 1. If the number of zeros or number of ones are more than number of zeros, is that possible? The second player could not have played more number of times than the first player. So that is invalid. Any other combination is invalid. So he returns minus 1. In fact, I would think even this condition is not required. There is actually a simpler solution if you count only the number of minus 1s. That is, you assume that the numbers are either zeros, 1s or minus 1s. Then the next turn can be obtained only from the count of minus 1s. How? Depending upon whether they are odd or even. However, it presupposes that the numbers of 1 and numbers of 0 are in proper fashion. That means they either same or they differ only by 1. Otherwise, somebody has goofed up in sending the configuration. Here is another solution where a wide count function is defined. It has a variable, it's a variable C0 and variable C1, and these are passed by reference. So that means whatever are the original C0 and C1 variables, they will be affected if they are changed here. The variable X is one of the 9. When you come here, that variable is examined. If it is 0, C0 is incremented, else C1 is incremented, if it is 1. If it is neither, none of the counts are incremented. So notice how the author has cleverly avoided writing very long statements in the program. All that the author does is count of x1, count of x2, count of x3, count of x4, these are all function invocation. So the same function, count of x, is being invoked. There is no assignment, no nothing. No value return is expected because the calculations of the counts are being done inside the function using variables which are passed by reference and which are defined. These are the definitions. This is the main function. So in this function, int C0 and C1 are defined as integer variables. The poor fellow started off by examining each individual variable, but I want each one of you to appreciate what the program is doing. Generally, whenever we talk of functions, recursive or otherwise, we have always seen the function references coming in some assignment statement. Y equal to function of something, y equal to n into function of something. We have ordinarily not yet encountered in a program that we write a function which is just a standalone invocation like this here. Please remember that when I invoke a function like this, count x1, the value returned is not going to be used anywhere. So there is no point in having a function which returns a value if it is going to be used just as a standalone call. The objective of this function is somehow to go here with a different variable each time. Once with x1, once with x2, once with x3 and so on. And all the if statements that you are ordinarily required to write for each of these variables independently are now cleverly written inside this single function here. So if the variable that you get is 0, you increment the 0 count. If the variable that you get is 1, you increment the 1 count. And after these 9 invocations, all your decision is going to be based only on C0 and C1. I have not examined whether this invocation is right or wrong. Please look at this and comment whether this will work. If C0 is equal C1 plus 1, player 2's turn. C1 is the count of 1's, C0 is the count of 0's. Number of 0's is 1 more than number of 1's. So clearly second player's turn. And return 1. Else, C out, player 1's turn, return 0. Of course, Mridul is expecting that the fellow who is calling this function with these 9 variables is not behaving idiotically and is sending me a configuration which has only zeros, ones and minus ones and nothing else. That's the assumption, right? So basically it's a valid thing. But if these two conditions are not correct, it's returning minus 1, because any other combination where the number of zeros and number of ones mismatch by more than 1 is invalid. So is a good solution here. So this was just another way of doing things. Understood? All right. Let's go to the next solution. Where instead of if and else, the person is simply counting all zeros independently and all ones independently. The only difference between this and a solution with else is that in the solution with if and else, the else condition will not be examined if the if condition is true. So the number of comparisons that you will do by using an else clause are going to be totally less, because each number is either 0 or 1. If it is 0, you just calculate it. If it is 1, you may fall into the else clause. Whereas here, you may do everything. For example, in a case where both numbers are equal, you may actually end up doing extra comparisons, but the program will work correctly anyway. All right, go to the next problem. So look at this problem. Given a configuration of tic-tac-toe, we want to determine if there is a winning or losing move of the next player. So what is the winning move of 0? A move of 0 from which there is at least one way for 0 to win, no matter how one plays. No matter how one plays, there is going to be a win for 0. At least one way. There could be more than one way. And winning move of 1 is similarly defined. Here is an example. So this is a configuration. All the remaining ones are minus 1. So this is 0, 1, 0, 1. Now, it is the turn of 0. So please note, the winning move does not mean that 0 or 1 wins immediately. A winning move means that a move by 0, which if played, then no matter what one plays next, 0 will always win. Now the same way for 1 as well. So look at this. If the next move is that of 0 and he plays here, then the winning move of 0 is x7 equal to 0. Is this the only winning move? If instead of this, if I move here, is it not also a winning move if I put a 0 there? Because the second player can either block this diagonal or can block this diagonal, but not both. Now there are two winning moves. The question that we have to answer is, a move of 0 from which there is at least one way for 0 to win, no matter how one plays. So this is good enough. This move of 0 here is good enough. one can win like this, or one can win like this. One meaning zero. Zero can win like this or like this, no matter what one plays. So guaranteed win for zero, no matter how one plays. Now this is the next stage in the game. You have already written a function which tells you back as to whether the configuration is correct and whose move is next. Now suppose you have 0th move. So you have to determine whether there is a winning move for you. Or if you are one, you have to determine whether there is a winning move for one, for you. So how will you determine that? Instead of this example, I am 0, I played this, one played this. I am 0, I played this, one played this. Now in this case, do I have a winning move? Why I do not have a winning move? Because if I play anywhere here, 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 here or here, do I guarantee that whatever one plays I will win? No. In fact, if I am stupid enough to play somewhere here, the next player will play one here and I will lose immediately. So not only there is no winning move, but there are a set of losing moves for me. So in this particular case, next move of the zero, there is no winning move, because cannot guarantee win for zero for any next move. However, I can find a losing move for zero. A losing move from which there is at least one winning move for the opponent. Thank you.